Definitely ain't gonna wind up with 175 because they're gonna subtract that debt. But if you had that same amount of money in the trust, the person who's the beneficiary keeps all the money. That's the difference. You can do your own research on it. You can look up on Google the wills. You can see now the executive, when a person dies with a will, the probate court designate what you call an executive administrator. And that person helps sovereign properties, cash, and this type of stuff. But the probate judge is going to make sure when they pull up your Social Security number that you owe different creditors, and the creditors going to get paid before you, as a person supposed to receive the money that's in a will. But if you go with the trust, it bypasses the probate court. So that's the difference. If you call, my email address is danielwatlington50@gmail.com. You can send me an email stating that you want to look at different types of trusts. And as I stated before, I'm hooked up with PACER.com for criminal civil matters. I have all of the database computer disk for trusts. Basically, when you go to paralegal school, they start you from the basic of common law. And from common law, they teach you all the way through to Magna Carta in 1215. King Edward was King Edward. It was called common law. Common law is way better than legislative law. And the reason they use common law, Pennsylvania is a common law state, Virginia is a common law. The reason why I like common law, because you can settle your disputes in common. And what that means is if you owe me some money, rather than taking you to court, I send what you call seven step called notice in demand letter. But I have to send a certified mail with a return receipt. You have 30 days to respond. So you're acting as a judge, an individual to collect the debt. Now, if you didn't respond in 30 days, then I send you another letter certified and put you in default. When I put you in default, right, I get the notary sign off on it again. Then I give you another 30 days. And in other words, you have to go through those seven steps. Then at the end, to make it short, the sixth step is where the notary signs off on and you get what you call the default judgment. Well, the default judgment in common law in the private administrative court is the same judgment that you would get if you went to a on the civil side of a court and the judge issued you a judgment. He issued you a default judgment, then he issues a final judgment. When he issued a final judgment, right, you can take that judgment from the court and you can go down to the sheriff, take it, pay him a fee, then he'll go out and collect off of the judgment. These are things later on that we'll talk about how to collect a judgment off of common law. But right now, we in the common law things that I'm talking about today, which is better than Congress setting up. When they set it up, they have 535 members in Congress. They have two senators per state. Congress create what's called legislative law. That's when they go in and vote on legislate and create these new laws out of 327 million people. They do it in the benefactor of themselves for the federal government and for the state to regulate laws that you have to abide by. And the IRS is governed where you have to pay your taxes, state and federal. We'll talk about that later on. But when you call me. I could help you and assist you creating these things. When I give it to you, I just can't say, well, this is that, because I can't give you the legal advice. Now you can take what I got. They have plenty lawyers in Florida. In Florida, did I have telephone number that once you do it, you can send it to them. They'll help you file it. But I can do all the same stuff. I just can't elaborate and give you the legal advice. So I have a service disclaimer that I have to state that. All I'm doing is basically being a paralegal, telling you things that you can do to protect yourself, and it's called asset protection. Or you can go on Google, type in asset protection. You got plenty of lawyers out there that'll set it up, but it's expensive. They can set up irrevocable trust, revocable trust. Now, the reason why you're setting up an irrevocable trust, because it can't be revoked. But if you set up a revocable trust, the government can get your money anytime. That's the difference. A revocable trust means that you commit a crime, you owe a fine of fines or restitution. The government can go in, and since it's revocable, they can automatically revoke that trust themselves and get all your cash. So the key point is, it's called irrevocable trust. Check them out yourself and look up the difference between irrevocable and revocable. And revocable, you'll see that the government can get your money. But if you do the irrevocable, you have to wait the 5 years, but you're protecting your house and asset. And I've seen a lot of elderly people who work all their life, have a house, they owe a debt to the mortgage company. Remember, if you owe a debt to the mortgage company, whether it's a 30-year note, you don't own that house. And even after you make the last mortgage payment, you still got to pay your property taxes. So you're still stuck there. You don't pay your property taxes, the county, state collector can garnish your wages or take your house. And then you can go 30 years and get almost 28 or 29 and spend all that money in there. Just say you get sick, you're working, you was paying the mortgage company on time, all of a sudden you have a stroke, heart attack, you can't work, now you're on disability, but you don't have enough money coming off your disability check to pay your mortgage. When you go 3 months behind, the mortgage company is going to foreclose on the house and they're going to demand the note in full. And what I mean by that is, every what balance that you owe, whether it's 80,000, you got to pay it right then. Now, when they foreclose on it, all that money that you paid in for 28 and 29, you done lost all of that.